So as we began this morning with our sermon, I sent out an email on Thursday about some pre-reading. Quite a lengthy pre-reading from Genesis, I believe chapter 25 on to chapter 32. So we have a pretty long story here this morning about Jacob and Jacob's wrestling with God. And much of what I'm going to talk about this morning deals with leading up to that wrestling match, if you will, with God. So if you have your Bibles with you, you might want to pick those up and turn to the 25th chapter of Genesis and kind of follow along, or maybe pull your Bible app up with you. We're going to cover a lot of territory this morning that we might kind of make sense of this wrestling match that Jacob has this morning with God. In thinking about this, I was reminded of an old story that I heard a long time ago about a young boy who came upon a cocoon that had a moth in it, and he could tell that the cocoon was moving and wiggling, and so he thought, well, you know, I'm gonna watch and watch this moth or whatever is inside of there come out. And so he kind of breaks the branch off and he takes it home and he watches it for a while, and he noticed that there was a tiny opening in the cocoon and the moth was inside and struggling to get out, and it would struggle, and the opening would get a little bit larger, and he would struggle even more and more. But the little boy, he just couldn't wait, and he felt like, you know, I need to help this little creature out a little bit. And so he took some scissors and snipped it a little wider and pulled it open and helped the little creature make its exit. And when it did, it fell to the ground, and its little wings were just shriveled up, and it couldn't do anything but just kind of flop around. But he didn't realize the whole process of emerging from a cocoon was to strengthen the wings of what is inside. And in that strengthening, in that struggling, it is God's way of strengthening that creature so it can be able to handle what is on the outside, if you will, of that safe place inside the cocoon. So, in essence, the little boy pretty much damaged what should have been a strengthening moment for the little moth. You know, struggling has a place in God's divine plan, not only for little moths, but for all of God's creatures, I suppose. A time when we might strengthen ourselves in order to be able to fly, if you think of a moth, or be able to handle the situation, the environment that we have put ourselves in. This morning we had that story, that struggling story from Genesis, the story of Jacob, and how he had his share of problems, and how he needed to work those problems out in his struggling with God's help in our text this morning. And I think we'll find in our story this morning that Jacob admitted that he had a problem. He confronted that problem, wrestled with God in prayer about it, and he was able to hold on and come out pretty good with his situation. He came out a changed man, if you will. So let's jump over to chapter 32, Genesis 32, verse 22 through 31. I'll share the rest of part of Jacob's story with you. Hear the word of the Lord. The same night he got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God's face. I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, leaping because of his hip. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So before I get into this wrestling match a little bit, I want to go back to Genesis 25, some of the pre-reading for today. And let's do a little bit of a recap here, because I think it's vital to the story here. Many of you know Jacob. You know Jacob's story. You know that he had a brother named Esau. You know that they were twins. The Bible says in Genesis 25, verse 22, that they even struggled with one another in the womb. And then as we move forward in verse 26 of that 25th chapter, we find out that when they were born, Esau is actually born first. Jacob follows, but he has a hold of Esau's heel. And so they name him Jacob, which means heel grabber, a contender, a competitor, or struggler. And from birth, Jacob always tried to get the upper hand on whoever he dealt with. It didn't matter who they were. Jacob was about Jacob. He was probably one of the more self-centered individual that we have in our Bible. For example, you know the story of Jacob stealing Esau's birthright when he came in from hunting in verses 29 through 34 of Genesis 25 here. Esau was so famished that he gave his birthright up for a bowl of stew. And then when later on in that chapter, when Father Isaac was dying and ready to bless his oldest son, Jacob dressed up like his brother and came and stole that blessing from him, tricked his father more or less in Genesis 27. The whole chapter deals with that. In fear of Esau, Jacob has fled the land of his ancestors, and he went to go live with his uncle Laban. And if you know that story in all of Genesis 28, Jacob tricks Laban and pretty much wears out his welcome there. And so he's off again. Jacob seems to cause conflict wherever he goes. He never deals on the up and up. And the first question that comes to our minds this morning as we get toward our verses that we want to focus on is what is Jacob up to now? You know, is Jacob tired of being a crook, a cheat, and a liar? Has the Spirit of God touched his heart, been working deep within his soul? Does he really want to repent and start his life over? We don't really know, but we can look back at all these places in Scripture that talks about his story. And you know, he's never lost contact with God. He's always talked to God and prayed to God. And so maybe he's on the up and up. You know, in fact, in Genesis 31, verse 3, we find that it was God who convinced Jacob to change, to turn around and go back home, make amends with Esau. And he promised him that, he said, "I will be with you. I will be with you." And so I think the first lesson that we can learn from this or take away from this is God is with us no matter what we've gotten ourselves into. We've all made mistakes in life. We've all made poor decisions. We've all spoken at times out of anger and wish we had those words back. And you know, God never abandons us when we take the wrong road in life. God doesn't give up on us. God continues to try to reach us and speak to our hearts. God continues to lay things on our hearts, trying to nudge us from the depths of our souls to make the right decisions, to change our lives, to turn around. So I can assume that Jacob is on the up and up, and he wants to change. His heart's broken here. And as that heart breaks, the Spirit of God has got in the little crack of his heart, I guess, and planted a little seed there. That's beginning to sprout. He's had enough of the crooked life. He wants to make everything right. The first place Jacob needs to start is from the beginning with his brother Esau. And so as he heads, gathers all he has, and he heads toward home, he sends some messengers out, and the scripture says that they come back with the news that not only is Jacob heading toward Esau, Esau is heading toward Jacob, and Esau has 400 men with him, and that's all that he knows. That's the news that they bring Jacob in verse 6 of chapter 32 here, and I want you to know that the fear that Jacob feels in that moment, because he doesn't know what's going to happen, triggers one of the most heartfelt prayers that Jacob has ever prayed in his life, which makes me think, what might that be for us? What is the most heartfelt prayer you have ever prayed? I know for me, it included tears and pleading and agonizing, so we can put ourselves in Jacob's place here. So it's night now. It's night. And Jacob begins to pray. Now, this is not the resting prayer. This is the night before. But he's consumed with this fear. And so he goes to God in prayer. Verse 9, Genesis 32, 9. And we find out here that the first thing he does, he acknowledges what God, or who exactly God is. He says, O God of my father Abraham, and God of my father Isaac, O Lord, who said to me, return to your country and to your kindred, and I will do you good. And then in verse 10, he confesses. Jacob says, I'm not worthy of the least of all the steadfast love and all the faithfulness that you have shown to your servant. For with only my staff I crossed the Jordan, now I have become two companies. But Jacob realizes that God has blessed him, even though he has not been worth blessing. He has not been faithful. And now that Jacob has been honest with God and thanked God for the blessing that he didn't even deserve, and just laid his sins before God, and Jacob lifts up he just gives it all. You know, through this agony, he gives it all to God. And he realizes that God has always been with him. God has not ever left him or forsaken him. Paul writes in Philippians 4:6, have no anxiety about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. What God says is, bring it all to me. Don't hold anything back. Bring it all to me. I can handle it all. And that's what Jacob does. Genesis 32:11. Jacob says, Lord, deliver me, please, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I am afraid of him. He may come and kill us, the mothers and with the children. And you have said, I will surely do you good and make your offspring as the sand in the sea, which cannot be counted because of their number. And the next morning, Jacob, he puts together a peace offering. He gathers a bunch of goats and rams and camels and cows and bulls and donkeys, all totaling 580 head of livestock, and he sends messengers with them, and he sends them to Esau as a peace offering. Basically, what he's doing, he's returning his inheritance. He's seeking forgiveness. He's confessing to Esau. So Jacob has prayed for deliverance from his brother Esau, and then he made a plan to work that out. To work that out. Jacob does not pray and then just step back and doesn't do anything. He doesn't wait for God to take action. Jacob, he prays and then he goes to work. Jacob steps out in faith, trusting God to be at his side as he returns the possessions of the stolen birthright, plus more. You know, prayer is not a process of trying to change God's mind. God already wants the best for us. Prayer is a process of changing us, who we used to be into what God wants us to be. And Jacob had been wrestling with God in prayer this whole process, all through these chapters that we've read here. This wrestling has been taking place way before the wrestling match in our text. The whole time he's decided to change his life with sin and make things right. So beginning in Genesis 32, verse 22, as we start our text, it's nightfall again, and Jacob will face Esau the next day. And he still has some wrestling to do. His fear continues to eat at him and continues to consume him. And you know, it was the man Esau that Jacob feared most of all his life. And therefore, when the Bible describes this, the Bible says that it was a man that wrestled with him until daybreak. Now, was Jacob physically wrestling with God? Was he wrestling with an angel of God? Or was Jacob having a dream, and in that dream he was struggling with his conscience and how he wronged Esau, and also wrestling with the remedy that God laid on his heart to solve this issue? Theologians struggle with this issue as well. We really can't be sure, can't be for certain what actually took place, but you know as well as I do that dreams can be very real. And this was as real can get for Jacob. Hosea 12:4 describes this event by saying that Jacob wrestled with the angel and prevailed. He wept in repentance and sought his favor. That means that Jacob struggled with his sin. He fought, he wrestled, he wept, he pleaded, he begged, he agonized. And he prevailed in prayer. Sound familiar? Have you ever prayed a prayer like that? You know, maybe it wasn't even a prayer of repentance that you prayed or I prayed. Maybe it was another issue that we wrestled with in the past or even now. But what is the case? James 5:16 says the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. You know, there's no way that Jacob could have wrestled with God and prevailed unless God wanted him to. Remember, God always wants the best out of us. God wants the best for us. When God was convinced that Jacob was sincere in his heart, sincere in his prayer, and wouldn't let God go, he just kept going and kept going, and it was then that God blessed Jacob with victory. And knowing the name of God seen God face to face and survived, wrestled with God and survived. And Jacob's life was changed. Folks, we're no different than Jacob. We have our own issues in life that we need to wrestle with God about. But you know, the beauty of this story that I love is that God loves us enough to let us wrestle. To let us wrestle. All the while helping us grow in our faith and strengthening our faith through that experience of wrestling in prayer. The bottom line is prayer isn't for God. Prayer is for us. My question is there something that you need to wrestle with God about? I can promise you, God is waiting. God is waiting for each of us. Father, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for Jacob and his wrestling. It helps us, oh God, to know that we too, no matter what is going on in our lives, that we can wrestle. We can wrestle with you. And we can prevail with your help. We love you and we thank you. In Christ's name we pray.